Let me put a brackets before I read the quote, saying, "I'm such a smug, virtue signaling pile of trash that I'm going to announce my intent to violate the law and interfere with someone's contract because I'm too stupid to know that this is illegal."
Wow. How screwed is Mark Wade? Let's find out.
So if you've been hurt and it hurts real bad, or if you have feelings that are making you sad, then it's okay. It's okay to cry.
As you can tell, these SJW comics pros somehow know even less about the law than they do about publishing remotely likable comics. Outstanding. To give a quick recap, Richard C. Meyer is the man behind the Diversity in Comics YouTube channel. In the months of April and May of 2018, he launched and promoted an Indiegogo campaign for his comic, Jawbreakers Lost Souls. And being a longtime lover of comics, Meyer opted to throw support behind small comic shops by creating a physical copy of the work that could hit the shelves. To do this, Meyer had finalized a deal with a small publishing company called Antarctic Press. This occurred by May 9th, the time the Jawbreakers campaign closed, and soon after, Antarctic Press released this, showing that yes, the company had every intention of publishing Meyer's comic. And that's when Mark Wade released this statement to his followers, which not only shows Wade's clear intention to interfere with Meyer's contract with Antarctic Press, but hints towards Wade's intention to slander Meyer in order to do so. In the face of this, the anti-ComicsGate crowd have become one giant virtue signal in the form of hashtag #IStandWithMarkWade, acting smug and legally untouchable because for years, they essentially have been. They've been allowed to tell lies, slander, and outright ruin lives without any repercussions. And they seem to be under the laughable impression that the Meyer vs. Wade trial is going to take place in one of their little social justice powwows. But this isn't Twitter. Hurt feelings and fake tears aren't admissible as evidence. And saying mean things isn't illegal, at least not in America. And as much as they dislike it, being right-wing still isn't a crime. Now, comic skaters have been tossing around the term tortious interference, mainly because that's the legal term for what Mark Wade may have committed. But what does a tortious interference case actually look like? What do judges take into consideration? And more importantly, how screwed is Mark Wade? Tortious interference, also known as intentional interference with contractual relations in the common law of torts, occurs when one person intentionally damages someone else's contractual or business relationship with a third party, causing economic harm. What some people don't realize when it comes to the American court system is that one of its central pillars is legal precedence. In other words, when a judge considers a judgment, he looks at other similar cases to see what was done last time. Take a look at any court record and you'll see multiple citations of past court cases to support the judgments. That way, rulings can be applied consistently. See, the court is the realm of evidence, not delusions, which is probably why Marvel's assorted grotesqueries prefer mobs in the court of public opinion. So, looking at older cases concerning tortious interference isn't just useful to give us an idea of how these cases work, they're also an open window to see how Meyer versus Wade will go. United Truck Leasing Corporation versus Ronald Geltman took place in Middlesex, Massachusetts, back in 1988. Now, so you can better tie this in with Meyer versus Wade, in this case, United is the accuser, which designated the company as the plaintiff, the same designation Richard Meyer will have, while Ronald Geltman is the party being accused of wrongdoing, which designates him as the defendant, the same designation Mark Wade will have. And in this case, the plaintiff lost. But let's take a look as to why. United accused Geltman of intentionally interfering with business dealings it had with another company called Matthew's Salad House. Geltman worked for a company called Industrial Fleet Management, which basically renegotiates truck leasing rates on behalf of companies that lease trucks. Sounds pretty straightforward, right? Well, it is. Mostly. It's the details of the case where things start to get a little dicey. However, they also show why social terrorist Marvel's little narrative of Meyer's an asshole, therefore Wade is right, is about as limp and useless as a male feminist. Geltman was a pure hustler. He was out to put money in his pocket and he conducted business like an asshole, and often to the expense of United Truck. Geltman would approach a company that leased trucks to transport goods. Part of his job was to save them money by finding errors and loopholes. The other part concerned renegotiation. He would approach the company his client was leasing from and ask them to lower the rates. If they refused, Geltman would go to the leasing company's competitors and gather bids for the contract. Geltman would then return to the leasing company with an ultimatum: either lower your rates, or his client would not renew their contract and would move to another leasing company. Occasionally, Geltman would give some companies preferential treatment if they tossed him leads. For example, if a company gave him leads to work, Geltman would tell them how much to bid in order to secure a contract, and then still might give the contract to someone else. To quote an instance when Geltman approached a United Truck competitor, Truck Center, Truck Center bid at Geltman's instructions at least 3 or 4 times. Geltman told Truck Center that their bids could knock the socks off any competitors, especially the plaintiffs. As a consequence of Geltman's strategy, the plaintiff eventually lowered its existing contract rate to retain the account. Later, when Truck Center's leasing president expressed dismay at not receiving the Caradonna account, Geltman told him that there was another United account, Fulton Packing, in which he said, "I'll bring you in. That's a lot of trucks involved there. We'll make sure you get that one, or we'll work hard to get you that one." Like I said, Geltman was kind of an asshole. United Truck had two very big problems with Geltman specifically. See, Geltman would often involve himself in the contracts United Truck had with their clients. Geltman caused them to come down or outright lose contracts in the past. But when Geltman approached companies to bid on leasing contracts, United Truck was never considered. You might think that's because Geltman had some kind of bias against United Truck. You would be right. To quote Geltman, "There's no obligation to call every leasing company in. Every other leasing company had given me leads. United Truck had not. Why should I give leads to a company that's trying to take food out of my family's mouth?" Sounds pretty bad for Geltman, doesn't it? He had a clear motive to make money, and he had a strong bias against United Truck. So let's take a look at the actual case. United Truck took Geltman to court for tortious interference over what occurred with Matthew's Salad House. United Truck had been courting Matthew's Salad House for about 6 years. Then the company hired Geltman, and soon after, Salad House started leasing out refrigerated trucks, but not with United Truck. The case centered on whether Geltman interfered with the dealings between United Truck and Matthew Salad House. To win the case, United Truck had to answer these 4 questions. 1. Did United Truck have an existing contract with Salad House? 2. Did the defendant know about the existing contract? 3. Did the defendant induce the other person into breaking the contract? And 4. Was damage incurred? United Truck tried to claim Geltman committed tortious interference because he convinced Salad House to go with a different company. They tried to prove Geltman did this out of bias, but for Geltman to be guilty, he had to have interfered with their contract. And you can't interfere with a contract that doesn't exist. Turns out, United Truck may have been trying to do business with Matthew Salad House for 6 years, but they never sealed the deal. So, United Truck had no contract, Geltman couldn't know about a contract that didn't exist, you can't induce someone into breaking a contract they don't have, and hypothetical damages aren't real damages. But my favorite part about this case was that Geltman was a straight hustler. He was an asshole, and it didn't matter. Sorry, Marvel. However, the presence of an existing contract is only half the battle when it comes to proving tortious interference. Steck vs. Sakowitz Inc. took place in Texas Supreme Court in 1984, and it's pretty comical. In the fall of 1976, Diane Steck began work as a clerk with Sakowitz Inc. In 1977, Steck was selected to participate in their executive training program. She eventually completed her training, but decided to leave Sakowitz Inc. just 4 months after graduation. Soon after, she fell right into bed with Oshman Sporting Goods and started work as an assistant buyer, the exact skill Sakowitz had trained her for. Bluntly speaking, she kind of kicked Sakowitz in the nuts, laughed, and peaced right out. This, as you can guess, is where the trouble started. Sakowitz had their lawyer send a legal letter to Oshman Sporting Goods, a letter that directly caused Steck to be fired. Up to this point, it seems Sakowitz, though still burned pretty badly by Steck, had no right to interfere with Steck's business dealings with another company. On the surface, this looked like a classic case of tortious interference. A contract existed that was subject to interference. The act of interference was willful and intentional. Such intentional act was a proximate cause of the plaintiff's damages, and Steck suffered damages and loss as a result of that interference. Pretty open and shut case. But here is where things go from Law and Order to Laurel and Hardy. Sakowitz spent a lot of time and money putting their people people through their executive training program. One thing they didn't want was for their graduates to take those skills and go running to their competitor. So on the second year of training, Steck and the other trainees were required to sign a non-compete agreement. Anyone refusing to sign would be dropped from the program. That wasn't going to work for Steck. She decided to sign everything else, but chose not to sign the agreement. She instead decided to bury the unsigned non-compete beneath the other documents and turned it in, hoping that her not signing would, quote, slip by and that nobody would notice. And it worked. Nobody did notice. So, 15 months later, she was allowed to graduate the program. Now, even though she was supposed to, Steck never signed the non-compete. It was Sakowitz's fault for not catching it. So, despite Steck's underhanded trick, it still seems Sakowitz was out of luck. They were going to lose, right? Well, spoiler alert, Steck lost this case, and here's why. Steck was missing one critical piece that would have won her the case. Malice. In order to successfully sue a party for tortious interference, the plaintiff, Steck, had to prove that the defendant, Sakowitz, acted with malice. Malice is legally defined as an act without excuse or just cause. Again, he hurt my feelings once isn't a just cause. Again, sorry Marvel. Sakowitz had acted in good faith when they sent the letter to Oshman Sporting Goods because they believed Steck had signed the non-compete. They had no idea Steck had only pretended to sign. And because Steck couldn't prove that Sakowitz had acted with malice, she lost. So how screwed is Mark Waid? Well, Waid, or one of the brilliant legal minds within the Comics Pros community, might say that no physical contract was signed between Antarctic Press and Richard Meier. But here's the problem with that argument. The original contract was made between Richard Meier and Antarctic Press, both of which officially reside in Texas. As far as I can tell, there was no physical contract. However, Texas is a state that honors verbal agreements as legally binding, as long as you can provide evidence that an agreement existed. So a signed document isn't required for the agreement to legally exist. And there's plenty of evidence to prove that an agreement had been reached between the two parties. And here's the best part. Even if Meyer's tweets and other messages enter evidence, they'll see that Mark Waid wasn't a neutral party in all this. He wasn't just a good citizen trying to fight the bad guy. They'll show that Mark Waid had hostile intentions against Meyer well before the Jawbreakers incident. Most importantly, when Waid made that call to Antarctic Press, Meyer and the publisher had already formed a contract. So, did a contract exist? Yes. Did Waid know about the contract? Yes. In fact, that's why he called. Did the defendant induce the other person to break the contract? Very likely. Waid made a call to AP, and soon after, Meyer's comic was dropped. Were damages incurred? Yes. Jawbreakers is sitting at over $400,000 from online sales alone. Who knows how much Meyer could have gotten from sales in-store. Even if he sold just 25% of his online number, his earned revenue would still be six figures, young lady. Unfortunately for Comics Pros, this isn't Twitter. This isn't the court of public opinion. This is just the court. So what are Meyer's chances? Richard Meyer is the guy who made Marvel Comics tremble from the front seat of his car. What do you think?